Richard Green. BBC
Radio Devon. And I've got to tell you that a couple of people have been getting the quiz question right already. Let's have a look. Wendy, regular listener Wendy. I know Geoff knows Wendy very well. And also JB in Exeter. Yes, you've got the two parts right. Part one. Which legendary star of the late 60s, 70s and beyond worked at a funeral director's and as a grave digger? And part two. Which American female lead singer of a band worked as a Playboy bunny girl before her success in the late 70s and early 80s. Two parts to the question, two answers, please. Text them 81333, starting your text with the word studio. And now it's time, after a break of a week, to welcome back Mr. Geoff Barker for Geoff Barker's Rock and Roll Roots and Shoots. Hello, Geoff.
Hiya, Richard. All right with you? How are you?
Yeah, not too bad, thank you very much. Yes, it's good to be back to normal, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Right, well, we kick off with a link back, actually, to the last time you and I were here, which was 2 weeks back. You played Gloria Jones' original version of a song, the big hit for Soft Cell, of course. We're talking about Tainted Love. And I mentioned Imelda May's great rockabilly version from her 2010 album Mayhem with Daryl Hyam on some fantastic guitar. And I said I'd play it, so let's kick off with that. Here's Imelda, Tainted Love. Wonderful. Imelda May and Tainted Love from 2010. As I said, another cover of the Gloria Jones original, which Richard played 2 weeks back. And Imelda has a new album out at this very moment in time. Jasmine Records, who are really great for putting out reissues and stuff, have got a series called Killer Bees, B apostrophe S, but they have a B on the front. Back in the days, if you remember when you bought a vinyl record, you don't get B-sides with downloads and stuff like that today, but it's a collection of great B-sides. There's two out. There's one of rhythm and blues hits and one of pop hits. This one comes from the pop hits. Now, the A-side of this was a stonking great monster rock and roll classic called Whole Lot of Shaking Going On from Jerry Lee Lewis. But this great song was on the flip side, which Cliff had a hit with the Shadows in the early 60s. But this is Jerry Lee's original version. It'll Be Me.
Well, if you hear somebody knocking on your door, if you see something crawling up across the floor, baby, it'll be me. I've been looking for you. Well, if you see a head or peeping from a crawled out a hole, if you see somebody climbing up a telephone pole, baby, it'll be me. All the forest, when I look in every tree. Well, if you feel something heavy on your fishing hook, if you see a funny face in your comic book, baby, it'll be me. And I'll be looking for you. If you see somebody hanging from a lamppost bright, baby, it'll be me. And I'll be looking for you. But if you see somebody looking in all the car, and if you see a rocket ship on its way to Mars, baby, it'll be me. And I'll be looking for you. In the city, and the way the lights are blue, on the search countryside, all the haystacks too. Well, if you see a new face on a totem pole, if you find a lump in your sugar bowl, baby, it'll be me.
Jerry Lewis, It'll Be Me, from a CD called Killer Bees, American Pop Hits, containing great B-sides from all sorts of people like the Crickets and Dwayne Eddy and Dion Ventures, the Everly Brothers, Brenda Lee, Sam Cooke, Gene Pitney and many more. Written by the great Jack Clements, who was Sam Phillips' number two sideman at Sun Records, and recorded in 1957. Tomorrow is the third anniversary of the passing of my old radio buddy Stu Coleman. He and I started out on Radio 1 together on It's Rock and Roll in 1976. 3 years he's been gone. Tomorrow he produced and arranged, well, loads and loads of great tracks with loads of great people. People like Little Richard and Phil Everly and Cliff Richard and Alvin Stardust, The Jets and Billy Fury, and many more. But most famously produced virtually all Shaky's early 80s classics in his first albums as well. And Stu also played bass on them as well. He was in Shaky's road band. So I thought I'd play one of his great productions from those days from Shaky. This was Shaky's second number one from the summer of 1981, and there's a great little story attached to this. The idea of the song was thrown at Stuart by no other than Nick Lowe, and I'll explain all afterwards. But in memory of Stuart, who also used to present on this very radio station a programme called The Rocker Returns, if you have long memories back in the early 90s. For Stu, this is Shaky Stevens and Green Door.
Secret you're keeping. There's no
Good old Shaky. From his, what was it officially called? Singled Out singles collection, which came out just before Christmas. One of the many hits, biggest selling singles artist of the 80s. Aided and abetted by my buddy Stu Coleman, producing and playing bass on it. The idea of the song, after Shaky had had a big hit with This Old House, which was at number one, of course, Stu said he was coming out of a studio in London and he passed Nick Lowe, who was going in to do a session. And he sort of off the cuff said, oh, you've done This Old House. How about Green Door? Which was another sort of song from that similar sort of early 50s pre-rock and roll era. And Stu said, ding, little light bulb went off. And he thought, OK, why not? Let's have a go at it. And they did. And that was the result. Anyway, memory of Stu passed away tomorrow 3 years ago. Right, your vintage chart questions, Richard.
Yes, few people are getting it right at the moment. Which legendary star of the late 60s and 70s and beyond worked at a funeral director's and as a grave digger? And part two, which American female lead singer of a band worked as a Playboy bunny girl before the success she found in the late 70s and early 80s? Two parts of the question. A and B, ping your answers along to studio. Tell us what you think. Let's have a little look who's been having a go. Val and Graham, of course, regular listeners. Yep, you've got it right. Irv's tried to have a go at part two and got part two wrong, but got part one right. So have a rethink on that, Irv. And if you think you know the answers, 81333, start your text with the word studio. BBC Radio Devon. And Geoff Barker's back with part two of Geoff Barker's Rock and Roll Roots and Shoots. And there's an anniversary of the passing of one of the greats of rock and roll, isn't there, Geoff?
Certainly is. In fact, there's a definite link. This weekend in 1960 was Easter weekend. Yesterday was the anniversary of the death of Eddie Cochran, who was on tour in the UK, did his final gig at the Bristol Hippodrome and died after a car crash in Chippenham. It was also the birthday, he was 20 this day, yesterday in 1960, of Billy Fury, who was also on the tour, along with lots of other young British rockers. So I thought we might Billy Fury's birthday and then play a track from Eddie Cochran from 1960 when he was in the UK, and then play a track which is so brand new, it's still warm, from another guy who was on the tour and very much involved with Eddie, but we'll get to that. But let's kick off with a great track from Billy Fury. This was a hit later on in that year of 1960. As I said, he was on tour with Eddie Cochran and Gene Vincent. This song was first recorded by a guy called Jimmy Jones, who had hits with songs like Handyman and Good Timing. But Billy just blitzed the original version of this. This is Billy Fury and Wondrous Place.
Charms, a magic world in my baby bazaars. Her soft embrace left satin and lace. A wondrous place. What a spot in the storm to cuddle up and stay nice and warm. Away from harm in my baby's arms. A wondrous place. Man, I know where, when I'm in.
The great Billy Fury would have been 81 yesterday, second only to Cliff Richard in the chart stakes in the late 50s, early 60s. And that should have been a bigger hit for him. It got in the charts, but it should have been a bigger hit. A very, very sort of ethereal vocal on it. Now, he was on tour with Eddie Cochran. Eddie's time in the UK was hugely influential, not only the songs he was doing, but his guitar playing influenced all the young up-and-coming British guitarists of the day. They all waxed lyrical about him, like Hank Marvin and Joe Brown and many others. Eddie did 3 months of dates, several TV and radio appearances. On the 12th of March 1960, he recorded a session for Brian Matthews' highly popular BBC radio show, Saturday Club. And one of the many UK musicians he worked with him was on the tour dates, explains how Eddie, in his opinion, was directly responsible for bringing the music of Ray Charles to this country. Here's the young musician in question, Georgie Fame.
The strongest memory I have is when we turned up at the rehearsal at a little place in Soho to find out who was going to play with whom and who was going to sing what. And Eddie was just sitting there all on his own on a stool with the Gretsch guitar and the waistcoat. And he said to all the musicians that were assembled, has anybody here ever heard of Ray Charles? And maybe one or two purists put their hands up, but the majority, quite honestly, hadn't heard of Ray Charles. I hadn't. And he said, well, here's one number I'd like to do in my act. And he went, doom, doo, 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 boom, doo, 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 doo. That What I Say thing. And everybody went, what's that? And within 3 months, every guitar player in Britain was trying to play that What I Say thing. Thanks to Eddie Cochran, we all got introduced to Ray Charles's music.
Hey, mama, don't you do me wrong. Come and love your daddy all night long. Oh, yes, ma'am. You don't do me right. Tell your mama, tell your pa, gonna send you back to Arkansas. Oh, yes, ma'am. You don't do right. Don't do right. Yeah, yeah. See the gal with a diamond ring. Really knows how to shake that thing. Oh, yes, ma'am.
Eddie Cochran on the light programme's Saturday Club, presented by Brian Matthew, backed up by the Wildcats, including on bass, Brian Licorice Locking.
I remember rehearsing with Eddie down 44 Gerrard Street. I remember that. He was a gentleman, really. He was very quiet. He just stood there and said, hello, man. Nice to meet you, sir, and all that. Always all sir. But the thrill for me is when he opened up his guitar case. And I saw this burnt orange Gretsch guitar staring at me in the face. That was the moment for me. And we all sat round, and he taught us a thing or two, a different way of playing, because his style was different to what we were used to with Marty. Our rock and roll was swinging rock and roll, you know. And but Eddie says, no, do it this way. And we did the Summertime Blues and Come On Everybody. Different style, you know, What I Say, all those numbers, and we intensely rehearsed them until we got them off.
Eddie Cochran and the Wildcats, and a bit of Brian Licorice Locking, one of the many musicians who was so influenced by him when he came to this country, recorded a set for Saturday Club with Brian Matthew way back in 1960. Marty Wilde loaned his band, the Wildcats, to Eddie while he was on tour. And Marty has just recently put out a really excellent album called Running Together, showing he's in great voice. It's nearly all original songs, including this one, a very special tribute to a guy he knew well and was great friends with and worked on TV shows with. And if you listen to the end of this, you can hear Eddie and Marty chatting with some of the audio from a TV show that Marty did, which Eddie was on several times, called Boy Meets Girls. The song in question is simply called Eddie. Here's Marty Wilde.
Eddie and Gene came to England, here on a tour that would keep alive their names. Rock and roll needed heroes, so out on the road they came. One of them would lose a good friend, and one of them never would see his home again. But the devil was sure about the night that car went out, taking it. And traveling on to the cities, knocking them dead every time they hit the stage. Standing out in the spotlight, oh, what a sound they made. People were lost in their music. Now everyone could see how it should be. But the time was moving fast. This journey wouldn't last. Eddie, can you hear me calling? If I shout your name out to the stars, oh, and if we had the chance to talk again, would you play me your guitar? I still hear it. Oh, I know those songs so well. There was no one quite like you, Eddie, I know. Legends couldn't tell. All too soon it was over, and all too soon it would pass. But the question still remains, and there's one that I must ask. Why should his young life be taken? Why take a life that had so much more to give? And when I found the answer, faded its hair and shame. I'm left with my memories, and I go back to a time I used to know. And although that time is gone, some things remain so strong. Eddie, can you hear me call ya? If I shout your name out to the stars, chance to talk again, would you play me your guitar? I still hear it. Oh, I know those songs so well. There was no one quite like you, Eddie, I know. But the time is moving on, and I must go. So good night, Eddie.
Once more to the show, America's Eddie Cochran.
Thank you very much, Marty. Say, I hear you're just about ready to have the experience of a lifetime right now.
Yes?
Well, you're going to the United States, aren't you?
Yes, I'm going to your hometown.
Anyway, Marty, I hope you have a ball over there. Hey, where do I go to stay?
Just over there. Now, they tell me, Eddie, that you're as handy with a gun as you are with a guitar.
I like guns, don't you?
Oh, yeah, fabulous. But in this country, really, hunting and fishing and all this business, that's only for the old retired colonel type, you know?
Oh, I think it's just a matter of where you were raised, you know? Well, I was raised in Minnesota. And it's kind of a hunter's paradise there.
That's wonderful. Eddie, there was an old which I used to sing of yours when I first started, and it's become a kind of a rock and roll classic now.
Oh, you mean 20 Flat Rock.
I'd love to hear it.
Would you play me your guitar?
I'm pleased to know that while I'm away in America, Eddie will be continuing his tour of England, which takes him all over the place, and you're bound to see him, you must watch him. And you'll hear a song, probably which he's going to sing now.
Well, if anyone can do a song about Eddie Cochran, it has to be Marty Wilde. He knew him well, he toured with him. Nice, sincere tribute, I think, and good touch putting those clips of Eddie's appearance on Marty's TV show in 1960, throwing them in on the end. From Marty's brand new album called Running Together, he's sounding in great voice, all original songs, and his daughters Kim and Roxy join him for several songs as well. Excellent album, Marty Wilde, the great Marty Wilde, and he's still going strong and still touring and working. Okay, Richard.
Good. Now, listen, it's great, isn't it? Because there is always something new to learn about music. We discovered that the other week, didn't we, when we were talking about Tina Turner having first done the Aswad hit Don't Turn Around. And bearing in mind you're the rock and roll aficionado, I thought I'd tell you a little story about Elvis that I don't think you'll know about.
Go on in.
All right. 1974. Okay. Dolly Parton is on a bit of a hot streak. She'd just released two consecutive number ones on the US country chart with Jolene and I Will Always Love You, and was beginning to make inroads with the mainstream pop audiences around the world. Elvis called her up. He'd heard I Will Always Love You and wanted to record it as a cover version. Now, this is what Dolly has said. You can't imagine how excited I was about this. So I told him, this is the greatest thing that has ever happened to me as a songwriter. So, why have we never heard an Elvis Presley version of I Will Always Love You? Because the night before the recording session, his notoriously hard-nosed manager, Colonel Tom Parker, called up Dolly Parton and told her that Elvis wouldn't record the song unless she handed over half of the songwriting publishing rights.
Ah, yes.
So she said, well, that throws a new light on this because I can't give you half the publishing. I'm going to leave that to my family, Dolly told Tom Parker. And he said, well, then we won't do the song. And apparently Dolly cried all night. But of course, Parton did have the last laugh, because when Whitney Houston recorded the version of I Will Always Love You for the blockbuster movie The Bodyguard and the soundtrack, apparently the country star obviously still owned all the rights to that particular song and earned enough money from that song alone to buy Graceland. How about that?
That's interesting. Now, that, as I said, that was touched on briefly on... There was a country music documentary on one of the TV channels a while back, and she told that story briefly, but she just sort of said that she wasn't giving up her song writing copyrights to anybody. But that was typical of the Colonel. Oh, yes, absolutely typical.
Cheeky. So our vintage chart show quiz question: which star of the late 60s, 70s and beyond worked as a funeral director and as a gravedigger? Do you know, Geoff?
I should remember, and I can't get it into my head.
Okay.
It's gone, so tell me and I'll know.
Liz in Truro thought it was David Bowie, and it isn't. David in Dawlish didn't know the answer to the first half. Anna in St Andrews has got both parts right, and the first part was Rod the Mod, Rod Stewart.
Of course.
Yeah.
It was
and
Rodney.
Part two, which American female lead singer of a band worked as a Playboy bunny girl before the success she found in the late 70s and early 80s? In fact, she also worked for a BBC office in New York City as a bit of a secretary in the late 1960s. The answer to that is, do you know?
Well, that was Bunny Blondie.
Yeah, it was Debbie Harry out of Blondie, yeah. And Anna St. Andrews got that right. Several people got both parts right, actually. The answers were Rod Stewart and Debbie Harry. Next week, Geoff, do we know yet?
Well, next week, it's the birthday of the great Duane Eddy, the biggest selling solo instrumentalist of all time. And I'll be playing a version of one of his hits, which was a great big hit in the early 90s. I think you will know it. So we'll get to that next week.
Can I do some initials? Is there something like the initials A-O-N with it?
Could be.
Could be. All right, we'll tease everyone for next week. See you next week, Geoff.